Chapter 22 of The Ruin of Doriath. Hurin has been held captive on Thangorodrim for 28 years. And even though Turin is dead now and Morwen is wandering somewhere in the wilderness, Morgoth isn't done with Hurin's family just yet. He actually releases Hurin, who looks like a very old man now. So Hurin wanders down to the encircling mountains that surround Gondolin, hoping to see Turgon again. The eagles let Turgon know that he's there, but Turgon figures Hurin is probably a servant of Morgoth by now because he was held captive, so he does not let him in to Gondolin. And that's actually a good thing, because Morgoth's real servants have been watching Hurin and following him around anyway. So Hurin stands in front of the mountains yelling, "Turgon! Turgon! Remember the Fen of Serech! Oh, Turgon, will you not hear in your hidden halls?" And Morgoth's servants report this to their master, who is just pleased as punch. Great, so now Morgoth knows what neighborhood Turgon lives in, even though he doesn't know the exact address yet. So Hurin eventually makes his way down to the Forest of Brethil, and the gravestone of Turin and Nienor. And that is where he finds Morwen. "You come at last," she said. "I have waited too long." "It was a dark road. I have come as I could," he answered. "But you are too late," said Morwen. "They are lost." "I know it," he said, "but you are not." And then she tells him that she will die with the sunset, and she asks him how their children found each other. But he doesn't answer that, of course. Instead, they sit next to the stone, hold hands, and once the sun does go down, Morwen indeed dies. He soon grows very angry and wants to take revenge for the wrongs done to him and his family. He buries her in that same area, and here Tolkien mentions that once the entire land is covered by the sea, don't worry, you'll read about that in just a little while, this burial mound becomes an island. So Hurin goes south to Nargothrond, and it's there that he finds Mim, the petty dwarf, sitting pretty among all the gold and jewels piled high. Hurin exchanges some unpleasant words with the dwarf and lets him know that it was Mim who betrayed Turin to the orcs on Amun Ruth. And Mim's like, "Uh-oh, the jig is up," and he begs for his life, but Hurin just kills him right then and there. Hurin then takes the Nauglamir. Remember that fabulous dwarf necklace that Finrod used to have? Yeah, so Hurin takes that, and he moves on, this time to the border of Doriath, and the guards there take him directly to Thingol. Well, Hurin throws the necklace at Thingol's feet and basically says, "Here's your fee for taking such good care of my wife and children. It's the necklace that Finrod used to own before he, you know, went off into the wild with Beren on your errand." Well, Thingol understands why Hurin is so angry, so he doesn't say anything, even though he's getting pretty angry at being spoken to in such a manner. Then Melian says to Hurin, "Listen, you've been seeing through the eyes of Morgoth this whole time, and even though you can't help it, your vision's kind of skewed. We took great care of Turin when he was here, and the fact that he never came back to Doriath was not our fault. We would have loved it if he had returned. We also honored your wife and daughter, and tried to get them not to leave. So you're just talking with Morgoth's words now." And Hurin finally sees the light, and fully recognizes just how much Morgoth messed up his life. So, feeling sorry, he picks up the Nauglamir, gives it to Thingol nicely, and then he leaves Doriath, goes to the Western Sea, and casts himself into it, bereft of all purpose and desire. And so ended the mightiest of the warriors of mortal men. For a while now, Thingol has been getting more and more obsessed with the Silmaril, insisting on carrying it on his person at all times. And now he's pretty impressed with the Nauglamir, so he decides that it should be remade with the Silmaril set in it. Well, the dwarves of the Blue Mountains still come over to Doriath every once in a while and hang out there while they lend their craft and smith skills to the kingdom. So, when some great craftsmen from the southern city of Nogrod are visiting Menegroth, Thingol hires them to set the Silmaril in the necklace. They take one look at these precious treasures, and they immediately start to lust after them. But of course, they don't let on to what they're actually thinking. So Thingol spends all of his time after this watching them work down in the deepest smithies. But once they finish their task, they don't hand it over. They say, "What right do you have to this necklace? Our forefathers made it for someone else. That guy's dead now, so it's ours." And Thingol figures this is just a cheap excuse to really get at the Silmaril, so he basically says, "Do you know who you're talking to, you pipsqueaks? I awoke next to the waters of Cuivien, and way before your forefathers woke up. Get out of my house!" And the dwarves, of course, don't take too kindly to that, so they kill him right then and there. So died in the deep places of Menegroth Elwë Singollo, king of Doriath, who alone of all the children of Ilúvatar was joined with one of the Ainur, and he who, alone of the forsaken elves, had seen the light of the trees of Valinor, with his last sight gazed upon the Silmaril. The dwarves escape east with the Nauglamir, but most of them are killed quite swiftly. The necklace is brought back to Melian, who is just totally distraught. A couple survivors make it back to Nogrod, though, and when they get there, they tell everyone that Thingol had ordered them to be killed because he didn't want to pay them for their work. This is, of course, a lie, and the dwarves of Nogrod want to take vengeance. They ask the dwarves of Belagost if they would come and help, but those guys are like, "Nah, I'm gonna sit this one out. And you guys should rethink what you're about to do, too." The dwarves of Nogrod then gather an army and march out towards Doriath. Meanwhile, upon Doriath, a great change had fallen. Melian sat long in silence beside Thingol the king, and her thought passed back into the starlit years and to their first meeting among the nightingales of Nun Elmoth in ages past. So now Thingol's spirit is in the halls of Mandos, and because of their parting and her inevitable grief, her power recedes from the forest, and Doriath is now open to its enemies. So she tells Mablung to pay attention to the Silmaril and send word to Beren and Lúthien in Osiriand. Then she leaves Middle-earth and goes back to Valinor to muse upon her sorrows in the gardens of Lórien. In the meantime, the dwarves pass through the forest's borders, and the Sindar elves who live there are definitely no match for them and their heavy weaponry. They enter Menegroth and have the Battle of the Thousand Caves, where there are many deaths on both sides, including Mablung. The dwarves come out victorious, and they ransack the place, taking the Nauglamir with them. And meanwhile, let's zoom out and check in on Beren and Lúthien. They've been living happily together on Tol Galen for the past 34 years. Their son Dior, who's about 33 years old at this point, is married to Nimloth, a kinswoman of Celeborn. They have three children, two sons, Elúred and Elúrin, and a daughter, Elwing. Well, Beren and Lúthien have received word about Thingol's death, and they've also heard from the elves of Osiriand that a great host of dwarves just marched by, looking ready for war. So Beren and his son go to the river Asgard along with many green elves. And as the dwarves start coming back to the Blue Mountains after the Battle of the Thousand Caves, they're suddenly attacked by many unseen enemies shooting countless arrows out of the woods. Some of the dwarves do manage to escape this ambush, but they don't get very far because there came forth the Shepherds of the Trees, and they drove the dwarves into the shadowy woods of Ered Lindon, whence, it is said, came never one to climb the high passes that led to their homes. Wow, so the Ents were in on it too! So this ambush is called the Battle of Sarn Athrad, and in it, Beren kills the Lord of Nogrod and takes the Nauglamir from him. He brings it back to Lúthien on Tol Galen, and you know, she's so nice and kind that she actually feels sorry for the dwarves of Nogrod that their lord is dead. Oh well. Anyway, she's the one who winds up wearing the necklace, and when she does, she is said to be the vision of greatest beauty and glory that has ever been outside the realm of Valinor. I mean, you can just imagine, right? After this battle, Dior and his family leave Beren and Lúthien and go and live in Menegroth. Dior is Thingol's heir, so when he returns, he plans to bring glory to Doriath once again. So after he's established himself as king there, and a bit of time passes, one night, a messenger from Osirion comes and presents him with the Nauglamir. This is a sign that Beren and Luthien have died indeed, and gone where go the race of men to a fate beyond the world. And actually, some say that owning the Silmaril may have made them die more quickly than they normally would have, because the flame of the beauty of Luthien as she wore it was too bright for mortal lands. Well, Dior then puts on the Nauglamir himself, and he is his own vision of great beauty and majesty. But of course, rumor spreads throughout the lands that he now has the Silmaril, so the Oath of Feanor is awoken again. Now, no one dared to attack Luthien while she wore it, but it's really open season on her son. So the sons of Feanor gather and send word to him demanding that he hand it over, and Dior just doesn't answer them. So, one night, the sons of Feanor come to Menegroth and do a surprise attack. They fight Dior, who kills Celegorm, then Dior is killed. The sons kill Nimloth, Dior's wife, and Curufin and Caranthir are killed as well. Then Celegorm's cruel servants cast out Dior and Nimloth's two little sons into the forest and leave them there to starve. Maedhros feels bad about this, and he does go out into the forest to try to find them. He looks for a long time, but he never finds them, and no one knows what their fate was. This whole episode of Elf Killing Elf is known as the Second Kinslaying. If you recall, the first kinslaying happened at Alqualondë about 550 years ago. So this is just a part of the curse that is the Oath of Feanor. But some people of Doriath are able to escape the violence, including Dior and Nimloth's young daughter, Elwing. And these escapees actually managed to take the Silmaril with them, down to the mouth of the River Sirion.